Amen. Well, good morning, Forest Lake. How are we? Doing well? Hey, that's what I'm talking about. So this past Wednesday was just a crazy day for me. Have you ever had that kind of day where you just wake up and from the moment your feet hit the floor, it's just nuts. It's just insane. That was my day this past Wednesday. Woke up, and man, for whatever reason, I was just as hungry as I've been in as long as I can remember. So rather than have my couple of eggs and coffee, I had 2 dozen scrambled eggs and a gallon of milk for breakfast. It was insane. So then I got in my car, took our oldest daughter, taking her to school. She goes to school at the magnets. So took her to school about 10 minutes. On the way back, I was on 2nd Avenue, like right out here, and all of a sudden the car in front of me just swerves to the left and then slams on its brakes and then just guns it through the stop sign. So I just crept up, because I don't know what happened. So I crept up, and man, there smeared on the road was one of the ducks that live out here. Dude, and so I get out of my car, I put it in park, I put the flashers on, and I slowly bend down and put my hand on his back, and I just said, God, you're the king of the universe. You're the great healer, the great physician. So I'm just asking you to heal this duck. Then I just walked and got in my car and drove away. And man, like 100, I was about 100 yards from it, just right out here. Looked in my rearview mirror, and this duck started to flop a little bit, then staggered to its feet and slowly like waddle across the street. It's the craziest I've ever seen in my life. Just nuts. I told you a couple of weeks ago that I've signed up to play on the adult league soccer here in town. So we usually have games on Wednesday nights. So around 6 o'clock, I got in my car, drove to Sokol Park for our 6:30 game. 6:30 rolls around. No one is there from our team. Like, so we're supposed to have 7 people there at least. The other team has 7. We've got none, just me, which is basically none. So I somehow convinced the ref, hey, just let us play. Like, I'm here, they're here, let's play. So somehow I convinced the ref, we'll play the game. And I don't know how to describe the next 50 minutes. I played one of the most phenomenal games of soccer I've ever played. Like, despite the fact that it was me versus their entire team, I scored 11 goals. They scored no goals. It was the kind of domination you saw last night. Just me versus them. We just owned them. And by we, I mean me. And I don't know how often you've played 1v7 in soccer or in anything. It's just exhausting. So by the time I got home, I was spent. Hopped in the shower, settled into my PJs, and flipped on some TV just for some last-minute chill out. And I saw that the History Channel was actually playing one of my favorite shows, Band of Brothers. Anybody seen that? And so they were showing the whole thing, all 10 episodes. And each episode is like an hour long. So I said, I don't have 10 hours. I've got a few minutes. So I just watched the whole thing in 5 minutes. All 10 hours, 5 minutes, turned off the TV, dove headfirst in the bed, and I was out. See, I told you Wednesday was insane. Like, by the time I got to sleep, I had eaten 2 dozen eggs and drank a gallon of milk for breakfast. I brought a duck back to life. I beat an entire soccer team by myself and watched 10 hours of TV in 5 minutes. Anybody else have that kind of Wednesday? What'd you do? Go to work? That's lame. So here's what I know. For most of you, you heard me just describe my Wednesday, and you heard that through one of 3 kinds of lenses, right? You thought either he's lying, or he's crazy, or maybe he's telling the truth, and it's some sort of superhuman freak show. Like, for most of you, you heard what I just described to you through a grid that actually comes from C.S. Lewis, who wrote Narnia. And here's the grid. Either I'm lying, either I'm insane, or I'm telling the truth and should be on display at the Smithsonian or something. So that's how, and that's actually the same grid that people had in mind 2,000 years ago when this guy named Jesus started walking around telling people, hey, I'm God. Like, can you just imagine how awkward it must have been on Jesus' first day of class at school? Hey, everybody, tell us your name and something cool about yourself. Okay, hey, I'm Johnny. I like baseball. Okay, Johnny. I'm Susie. I like to draw. Okay. Hey, I'm Jesus, and I'm God. Like, that just lands, and they didn't have a category for that kind of claim, so they laid on top of it this grid. Either he's lying, he's crazy, or maybe he's telling the truth. Let me show you just one of those places where Jesus seems to say, hey, I'm God, and make the kind of claim that they just didn't know how to handle. It's in John chapter 8. So if you have your Bible, John chapter 8, we'll just read a familiar story, but one that I think, if we read it in the right way, can shed some light on the question we're asking this morning, which is, what are we going to do with Jesus' claim that he's God? Because if I say to you, I'm God, you got some questions. That was true 2,000 years ago, John chapter 8. If you don't have a Bible, it should be a hardback maroon one on the seat in front of you or maybe under you. Just grab it. If you don't own a Bible, that's our gift to you. Take it, add it to your collection, John chapter 8. Before we read this, just want to say, hey, glad to see you. I'm Patrick, one of the pastors here. We'll see what the Lord's up to in his word. John chapter 8, verse 48. John 8, verse 48. Hey, before that, let me just take a second here. I want to frame what we're about to read. So you're there, hold your place. Let me frame this. So about 2,000 years ago, this guy named Jesus, who was from this dumpy rural hick town, like the kind of place with one red light and one post office, and where men still thought wrestling is real. Like, he's from that kind of city, which is grimy and rural and dumpy. And he shows up and he says, hey, I'm God. I'm God in the flesh. The God that you, as Jews, read about, studied, knew about, that's me. And so when they hear him say things like that, they ask these three questions. And if we have more time, I'd show you each of these. Don't have time. Just want to read it and then point out a couple things. They asked, hey, is he lying? Is he just insane? Or is he telling the truth? John chapter 8, verse 48. Here we go. The Jews responded to Jesus, aren't we right in saying that you're a Samaritan and have a demon? In other words, what you're saying sounds insane. I don't have a demon, Jesus answered. On the contrary, I honor my Father and you dishonor me. I do not seek my own glory. There is one who seeks it and judges. Truly, I tell you, if anyone keeps my word, he will never see death. Then the Jews said, now we know you have a demon. Abraham died, and so did the prophets. You say, if anyone keeps my word, he will never taste death. Are you greater than our father Abraham, who died? And the prophets died. Who do you claim to be? We're going to have to answer that question before we get out of here this morning. If I glorify myself, Jesus answered, my glory is nothing. My Father, about whom you say, he is our God, he is the one who glorifies me. So now it's starting to sound a little crazy. You do not know him, but I know him. If I were to say I don't know him, I would be a liar like you. Okay, there it is. But I do know him, and I keep his word. Your father, God, Abraham, rejoiced to see my day. He saw it and was glad. The Jews replied, in other words, we're not dumb, Jesus. You aren't 50 years old yet, and you've seen Abraham, who lived at this point 1,000 years before. Jesus said to them, the kind of sentence that's going to get him killed later, truly I tell you, before Abraham was, what's that phrase? I am. So they picked up, watch this reaction. They picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus was hidden and went out of the temple. He did a Jesus juke. Now here's the question you should be asking about what we just read. What in the world? Like, what in the world just happened here? But because it seems like on the surface, All Jesus really said is, before Abraham was, I am. Like, and for the Jews Jesus is talking to, now Abraham was one of the heroes and the founders of their faith. He would have been a kind of cultural, religious superstar. So what Jesus is saying here is really like if I were to meet you for coffee and sit across the table from you and say, hey, listen, before Gandhi was, I am. Like Gandhi longed to see the day when I would show up and be on the earth because before Gandhi was, I am. And your response should be, you are what? You are dumb? You are high? What are you? So what about, if that's all Jesus is doing here, what about that makes them so angry that they want to throw stones at him and kill him? Like that just, if all he's doing is just saying words that don't mean anything, then it wouldn't make any sense for them to respond that way. So what about Jesus' phrase in verse 58 when he says, truly I tell you, before Abraham was, I am, evokes this kind of reaction. Well, here's what it is. If you remember, back in the Old Testament, Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, don't have time to turn there, just kind of take a note. God shows up to this guy named Moses and speaks to him through the bush, and he uses a name and a title for himself, and he tells Moses, hey, use this title when you're talking about me. It's the name, it's the title, Elohim, that for the Jews was considered sacred and precious and holy and reserved only for God himself. So you don't name your kid Elohim. You don't call your business Elohim. That's a name reserved solely for God. In fact, they took it so seriously that anyone who claimed to be the I am was considered a blasphemer. And in that culture, and still in some cultures today, blasphemy was a capital offense. It was the kind of crime that would get you murdered, put to death by stoning. Okay. So now we're connecting the dots. So that's why the Jews respond in this way, in this story. Jesus says, hey, I am. And everyone listening would have understood what he meant. They would have said, wait a second. You just used Elohim. You just said, I am the I am. I am God. Now, our skeptic, atheist, agnostic friends, remember, glad you're here. Hope you continue to tune in throughout the rest of this series. But they're going to say, ah, you see, Jesus never said in the scriptures that he was God. He never said, I am God. And man, that's true. Like you won't find Jesus saying verbatim, I am God anywhere in here. But what you will find are Jesus saying these kinds of things where he says something and everyone listening in that culture would have heard, interpreted, understood what he's saying as saying, I'm God. I am the I am. And so when they heard him say that, when they heard him say, I'm God, and they asked our three questions, is he lying? Is he a lunatic? Is he telling the truth? They just concluded he's either lying or he's crazy, or he's both, but he's just some bumpkin from no-name Nazareth who's never done anything. Maybe he's a cool dude. Maybe he makes some good pasta. Maybe he's got some good advice on morality. He got some interesting suggestions about how to achieve happiness or whatever, but he's certainly not God. So that was the knee-jerk response for most people 2,000 years ago. Jesus says, hey, I'm God. And they just said, no, you're not. Now, here's my question to you this morning. What's your response? Is Jesus just a cool dude who's got some interesting things to say about ethics and morality and some unique thoughts on how to live your best life now? Or is he God in the flesh? See, everybody has to do something with Jesus. Like, whether this is your first time in church in years, whether you think this whole thing's a little bit goofy and silly, whether you've been following Christ passionately for years, everybody has to do something with Jesus. When Jesus says, hey, I'm God, that's the kind of statement that demands a response, right? So 10 years ago, I met this beautiful young girl, my first semester in seminary, named Jacqueline. And not long after that, I did what any honorable, self-respecting, southern, chivalrous gentleman would do here in the South. I asked her out on Facebook, and I said, hey, you want to go grab coffee and maybe get married later? You want to do that? And man, she said, yeah. So not long after that, I got down on one knee, and I just opened the ring gates, and hey, will you marry me? I want to spend the rest of my life with you. God is in this. Will you marry me? And she said, yes. And here's the thing about the question, will you marry me? It's the kind of question, the kind of statement that demands a response. You got to do something with it. So if you ask your girl, hey, will you marry me? And she goes, oh, golly, man, I didn't expect this. Let me think about it. That means no. But she's got to at some point come back to you and say yes, no, maybe later, but probably not. You've got to do something with it. And when Jesus says, hey, I'm God, you've got to do something with that. You've got to either go, he's lying, he's off his rocker, or he's telling the truth. And he really is God in the flesh. So what's your answer? Is he lying? Is he crazy? Maybe both. Or is he telling the truth? Now, here's where we've got to be careful in how we answer this question. Because our skeptic and agnostic and atheist friends are going to say, hey, how do you know that Jesus was really God? How do you know that? And our knee-jerk reaction might be to respond in a couple of ways that seem helpful to us, but that when we're engaging the culture around us are actually going to be pretty problematic. Here's the first one. We might want to go, hey, we can point to what Jesus said about himself, which we already looked at some of that. We can just say, hey, look, Jesus said here, and he said in John, let me get the quote here, John 5, 16 through 18, write that down. John 10, 30 through 33, he says basically the same thing he says here. Hey, I'm God. So Jesus thought he was God. Jesus said he was God. Shouldn't we just believe him that he's God? Now, what's the problem with that kind of response? See, if that's how we're trying to engage our agnostic neighbor or our atheist coworker, they're just going to say, so? Like, the fact that Jesus thought he was God doesn't mean anything because he could have been lying or he could have been crazy. He could have done what I did and told you about my Wednesday and just been totally off. So he could have been completely wrong about it. It could have been a liar, could have been both. So how do we know? I mean, after all, Jesus wasn't the first person to claim to be the Messiah, right? If you don't believe me, just Google David Koresh or check out Waco on Netflix. Got this scrawny, weird-looking, thick glasses, half-permed hair dude saying, I'm God. I'm here to establish God's kingdom in a pasture in the middle of nowhere in Texas. So you could just say, hey, he's lying. Jesus is lying. He's just maybe David Koresh level insane. So we might want to point to what Jesus said about himself, but can you see the problem with trying to engage the culture around us if they don't share the kind of assumptions we share about who Jesus is? Okay, so if we can't point to what Jesus said about himself, maybe we can point to what Jesus' followers said about him. So we can look at passages where they say over and over again, every New Testament writer calls Jesus the Christ, which means Messiah, the anointed one, the one that God had promised to send to redeem the world. Or we could point to the fact that they seem to use some titles for Jesus that wouldn't make any sense if they didn't genuinely believe that he was God. Like, why else would they call him the Son of God, John 20, Savior, John 4, Lord, John 9, or God, John 1, if they didn't actually believe he was God? Okay, so surely the fact that Jesus' own followers thought he was God in the flesh and not just some good moral teacher matters for something. Surely that counts for something, right? Well, maybe. But they could have been deceived. They could have been manipulated. Man, they could have just been flat wrong. Like, come on, it's not really that hard to convince other people to believe something that is completely insane. Like, just a few years ago, we convinced teenagers to eat Tide Pods and post it on YouTube so we could see how moronic you are. Like, just think about it, just like a year ago at the beginning of the pandemic, we convinced people that the best way to protect yourself against COVID is to drink Clorox and take a bath in Lysol. So it doesn't, you just have to have the right kind of charisma and conviction and confidence to convince anybody of anything. So like surely we can say, well, Jesus' followers thought he was God. But we could point to what they said about him, but the skeptic's just going to say, well, that doesn't show anything either. Because Jesus could have been manipulating them. They could have been deceived. They could have been wrong. They could have been just as crazy as he was. Okay, so where do we point? Like, where can we turn to say to our skeptic and atheist and agnostic friends, hey, here's how we know. We have very good reason to know with confidence that Jesus really was God in the flesh. We're not going to point to what he said about himself or to what his followers said about himself. So where can we point? We point to the resurrection. The resurrection. So we can point to the fact that Jesus literally, actually, physically rose from the dead. We point to the fact that as Jesus got closer to the end of his life, he told those around, they didn't get it, but he told those around him, hey, I'm going to be crucified on a cross. And he was. Like virtually every historian worth any kind of credibility will agree to that. And then he also said, hey, 3 days later, I'm going to rise from the dead. And he did. He did. So he said, I'm going to die on a cross. That happened. He said, I'm going to rise from the dead. That happened. And that amazing news that Christ rose from the, just like he said he would, that's not something we heard about on Tucker Carlson or read about on Facebook. Like, that's something that anybody with access to a Bible can read because all four gospels give an account of it. Now, you may be going, okay, hold up though. How do you know that the gospels aren't lying? Like, how can you trust that they didn't just make up this story about Jesus' resurrection to save themselves the embarrassment of following this guy they thought would save the Jews and overthrow Rome, who in the end was betrayed by the Jews and killed by it? How do you know the resurrection isn't just some fictional, made-up story to try and save face? Man, that's a great question. I'm glad you asked it. I'm glad you asked questions that are next in my notes. Let me give you two quick reasons. There are a ton of them. Two quick reasons why we can trust that the resurrection we read about here in the scriptures isn't just some made-up fairy tale, some sort of feel-good rom-com story, but it points to an actual historical reality. Two quick reasons. Here's the first one. The empty tomb. That seems like pretty obvious, but the empty tomb. So one of the reasons that Christians believe that Jesus rose from the dead is that the tomb where his body was laid was empty. And if you go, yeah, well, of course, that's what the Christians would say if they were trying to convince you that the resurrection happened, but it really didn't happen. Okay, let me give you one way. This is kind of subtle, but really interesting. One way that we can know that the accounts of Jesus' empty tomb aren't made up. They aren't the kind of thing that Christians would fabricate to prove their point. So think back with me. In all four Gospels, who were the first people to discover that the tomb was empty? Who were they? They were women. Women were the first people to discover that Jesus' tomb was empty. And if you go, so what, who cares, then you just don't understand first century culture. See, here's what you got to know about first century culture. In the first century, the testimonies of women, the reports of women, were considered no better than that of slaves. In fact, it was illegal for a woman to testify in court because her testimony would be considered invalid. Okay, so think with me. If Christians were trying to make up a story about Jesus' tomb being empty, which is more likely? That they'd put in the story that Jesus' tomb was found by well-respected men in power and authority, or that his tomb was found by low-class peasant women that no one would believe? That's not a trick. That's a very easy one. Like, if we're trying to make up a story to legitimate the resurrection, we'd want well-respected, well-positioned men in power and authority, high class, to be the first ones to discover the empty tomb. We wouldn't put in the story that it was discovered by women whose testimony would be considered bogus by anybody who heard of it. Right, so one of the reasons we can rest in confidence, we didn't just make this story up, is because it has details in it that Christians would never include if we thought it was made up. Here's another one, though. This one, I think, might land in your lap for a lot of us. So we can point to the fact that, okay, we know that this isn't a made-up story because it has elements in it that we wouldn't make up, but then we can point to the transformed lives. We can point to the lives that were radically changed as people encountered the risen Jesus. So a few weeks ago, we said this. We said a few weeks ago that the personal experiences are hard to refute. They're incredibly difficult to argue with, right? So here's an example. A few days ago, walked into our oldest daughter's room, and she had spread on her mattress what looked like some kind of drug lab. I mean, she had like sand and some kind of like hourglass thing and seashell and slime. Like, what are you doing? She said, I'm making a mermaid potion, Daddy. I said, a mermaid potion. Because I'm a loving father, I said, you know mermaids aren't real, right? And she said, yeah, they are. I said, no, boo, they're not real. I mean, you just made a mess here. There's no potion, no mermaids. She said, no, yeah, they are, Daddy. I said, hey, I love you. Who's older? She said, you are, Daddy. I said, so I probably know more, huh? She said, no. So I said, they're not real. She said, yes, they are. They may not be real to you, Daddy, but they're real to me. Hello. So I quickly just walked out of the room lest I be cast into some kind of voodoo magic spell. But in the end, what was happening there? I lost that argument because what I said didn't align with her experience. Like, she'd had an experience with those mermaids she was making potions with that was deep and meaningful and real. And anything that didn't align with that experience, she just rejected. She said, here's my experience. Here's what happened. Don't know that I can explain it. Just putting it before you. And something very similar is going on with the resurrection. Just think about this. Like, almost overnight, this group of stumbling, bumbling, fumbling, can't get it together disciples is transformed from a group of losers to the most ferocious missionary force in the history of our faith. In fact, Luke tells us in Acts 17, they literally turn the world upside down. So what happened? How does that happen? Like, what happened there? The same thing that happened to the Apostle Paul in Acts 9. See, Paul, who's at that point, his name was Saul, was one of the most violent, most brutal persecutors of Christians living in the world at that time. And he hops on his little horse, and he's on his way to murder Christians. When the resurrected Jesus shows up, knocks him off his horse, saves him, says, get up and go proclaim the gospel. You can read about that. I'm not making that. So in Acts chapter 9, Paul in a moment, it seems, goes from murdering disciples to making disciples. Now, how do you explain that? Like, what's the best explanation there for that kind of life transformation? Maybe he was hallucinating. Maybe he saw a ghost. Maybe he was on shrooms. We don't know. But here's what I can promise you. People don't tend to die for hallucinations. People don't tend to give their lives for ghosts. And what history tells us is that all 12 disciples, as well as Paul, were gruesomely murdered for their faith in Christ. So maybe they're hallucinating. Maybe the best explanation is they saw a ghost and they made it up. Or maybe, just maybe, the best explanation for that kind of total life transformation that we've got testimonies about in this room is that they had an encounter with the risen Christ. That the tomb was empty. Like, they really did see the resurrected Jesus, and that propelled them and emboldened them to lay down their lives to make the gospel known to the ends of the earth. So how do we know this isn't just a made-up story? Because we can point to the fact that the tomb was empty, and we can point to the fact that lives since that moment to now have been transformed by the good news of the gospel. That you and I are born wicked. Just get around kids. You'll see that. And yet, God in his great mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, sent his son, God in the flesh, to bear your penalty, my penalty for sin, to pay the punishment we deserve to pay, and to rise again in victory over sin and death and Satan, so that we might know true peace and true life and true hope, which is what we're all after. So maybe the best explanation is that Christ lived, died, and rose again. And when that good news gets in your bones, you can never be the same. So here's what I've got to ask you this morning, as we close, because I love you. What are you going to do with Jesus? What are you going to do with Jesus? See, if Jesus didn't rise from the dead, then he was a liar, he was a lunatic, or he was both, but you shouldn't listen to him, trust him, or believe in him. Just another weirdo walking around saying weird stuff. But if Jesus did rise from the dead, and I've just given you several good reasons why we think as Christians that he did, then you've got to feel the weight of what that means. If Jesus really did rise from the dead, then it means that he really was God in the flesh. And it means that right now, at this moment, you got to get this, lean in, that Jesus is the sovereign King of the universe, who rules and reigns over every detail of every event that has ever happened or will ever happen in the history of the universe. And that means, you got to look right at me, because don't miss this, it's so important, but it's not popular. That means that at this moment, Jesus Christ rules and reigns over my life and your life. He rules and reigns over my life and your life. So the question is not, is Jesus Lord of your life? He is. He just is Lord of your life. The question is not, is he Lord of your life? The question is, have you gladly submitted to his lordship? Have you been brought to the place where you say, I'm done chasing career and money and sex and power and fame and influence? I just want to put that on the cross where Jesus paid for it, and I want to know Jesus. I want to walk with him, and I want my life to align with his, and I want to get near him, and I want to abide in him. So I'm not asking, do you go to church and read your Bible and listen to Christian music? I'm not even asking, are you a good person who doesn't drink, doesn't cuss, and always puts money in the Salvation Army bucket at Christmas time? I'm not asking that. I'm asking, have you submitted to Jesus' lordship? See, if Jesus rose from the dead, then it means that everything he said was true. And here's one of the last things he said before he ascended to heaven to be with his Father. He said, he looked at his disciples and he said, one day I'm coming back. And on that day, there are going to be two responses. Those who have gladly submitted to me, man, you better get in here. You better get into my kingdom. There's going to be weep, tears of joy, no more sorrow and pain and loss and grief. But for those who rejected me, there's going to be weeping and gnashing of teeth because they'll be separated from me forever. So what are you going to do with Jesus? You can willingly submit to him now and walk in the joy and hope and peace that he purchased for you. Or you can submit to him later when it's too late. See, if Jesus is God in the flesh, and here's what he promised us. He promises this. One day, every person in this room will submit to Jesus. You just will. We'll all stand before him and give an account for our lives. And we'll either plead the blood of career and resume and money and power, or we'll plead the blood of Christ. But we're going to plead something. We're all going to submit to him at one time or another. And that's happening regardless of our feelings and preferences and opinions about it. So my invitation is just this. Will you submit to him? Will you lay your life down and say, I'm done with me. I'm a terrible God. But you're the almighty God. And there's hope and peace and joy and life here. And I want to walk and I want to know it. While he's drawing and wooing. Right now, will you gladly submit to Jesus so that one day when he returns to gather his children, you won't hear, depart from me, I never knew you. But he'll look you in the eye because of what Christ did on the cross and say, welcome home, my good and faithful servant, get in here. Come dine at the table where you can experience peace and joy and life forever. Then, and the offer on the table is right now. So what are you going to do with Jesus? I'm just pleading with you to submit to him, to accept the invitation, and to walk in the peace, joy, and life bought for us in his death and sealed for us in his resurrection. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for truth, as heavy as it may be. We thank you for the gift of living in this cultural moment where we're having to give good, well thought out responses to hard questions, and we thank you for the Spirit's guidance and the Word's truth in helping us do that. For believers in this room, I pray that you would encourage them, give them confidence that we don't have some blind faith, we're just hoping it's all. We have good reasons for the hope that we confess. And for those in this room or listening online who don't know you, I pray that you'd open hearts, that you'd open minds, that you'd break people of this constant striving to be what they can never be, what they can never achieve, the satisfaction that just always seems out of reach, but that you've purchased in your life, death, and resurrection. I pray that you would transform lives. You'd make new creations this morning, and that we might get to celebrate with those that you save by your grace. If you keep your heads bowed and eyes closed, in just a second, Brad's going to come and lead us in closing chorus. I just want to invite you, if you felt the Lord pricking and prodding and pressing on you this morning, and you want to say, hey, I'm drifting here. At one point in my life, I was all in, but now I'm taking some chips back. Or maybe you want to say, I don't really know this Jesus you're talking about. I know religion. I know church. I don't know Jesus. I just want to invite you to take that little connection card in your pew and just very quietly, nobody's going to make a big deal about it, just write on there, hey, I need help, or I want somebody to reach out and talk to me about this. Or maybe today I decided I'm going to surrender my life completely to Jesus for the first time in a long time or the first time ever. And we want to celebrate that with you. So we invite you just to find someone, drop that in the plate on your way out, if you will, and we'll celebrate what God has done. Father, we thank you. We love you. We need you. For your beautiful name, we ask all these things. Amen.